I'm Tammy Kolda, an applied mathematician, and this is Unlocking LaTeX Graphics. On this YouTube channel, I'm providing a detailed how-to guide on using TIXI and PGFPLOTS. These videos are based on my book, Unlocking LaTeX Graphics, as well as some bonus materials. Today's topic is line plots in PGFPLOTS. I'll show you how to create a basic line plot using data from a file and how to show multiple line plots on the same axes. I'll demonstrate changing the line and marker styles, including when things can go a bit haywire. I'll show you how to plot data from two different files on the same axes. Finally, I'll show you how to change one or both axes to be logarithmic. If you want to know more about TIXI and PGFPLOTS, check out my other videos. I've already created a starting point for us at overleaf.com. The package PGFPLOTS here is, of course, essential because that's what we're learning about today. These other packages are just for my convenience. Parscript and full page just make things look nice, and hyperref is so that I can link the author name back to the YouTube channel. Before we get started, I'm going to set up some things using PGFPLOTS set. These first set of options are some recommended defaults. I went over these in the last episode, so I'm going to refer you to that to understand why I'm setting these options. The second set of options are just preferences for the plots we're going to make today. I choose a width and height that will be the same for all my plots. I'm setting up the font sizes for a bunch of the plot elements. It can be convenient to set these up front so that you don't have to worry about them every time you make a plot. To begin, let's insert a basic line plot. We covered this in the last episode, but I'll give a quick review. The TIXI outer environment is our drawing canvas. The axis inner environment sets up the axes for our plot, and then the addplot command actually draws the line. Here we specified that the line should be blue, and the mark should be an asterisk, which means a filled circle in this case. And then we're reading from a table in the file data.txt. And then every line should end with a semicolon. By default, we use the first column of data.txt for the x values and the second column for the y values. We can add options to the axis to specify the title and labels for the x and y axes. So here we have the title is basic line plot, and the x label is input, and the y label is output. Via options for the table, we can specify other columns to use as values for x and y. So here I'm going to say x equals a and y equals c. So this is telling me to read from different columns of the table. When I recompile, see what happens over here on the right. So we're now using a totally different set of x and y values. These are very basic options, and we'll cover other options for tables in another episode. I'll also note that I've already loaded the file data.txt into overleaf.com. So I uploaded this file data.txt previously. I've also uploaded some other files as well. Let's talk about putting multiple line plots together. We'll start with just one line plot. We can add more lines to the plot by adding additional addplot commands. Let me show you that here. For each of these plots, I've changed the color and I've also changed the plot marker. So the first one is diamond star, the second one is square, the third one is half circle star, and the last one is mark equals star. When I have an asterisk following the name, that means that it's filled in. So for example, square here doesn't have a star following it and the square is open. If I were to add a star, then when I compile it, the square would be filled in. The star is not anything that can be filled. If we see here, it's just like a plain star. To be able to tell which plot is which, we can add axis option to specify the legend. So we're saying the legend entries are A, B, C, and D. The order of these legend entries should correspond to the order of the addplot commands. Each legend entry is separated by a comma. If you need a comma inside the legend entry, then you should contain that legend entry inside curly braces. We put the legend position on the outer northeast. I covered those options in the previous episode, so go back and watch that if you want more information. Suppose we want to change our plot styles. Let me start again with a copy of our last plot. Suppose I want to change the lines to be thicker. I could go through and just type thick on each of the plots, and one by one, those would turn thick. You can see this cyan line is now thick. But a better way to do it, if you want to do it for everything, is to use a predefined style called every axis plot. This looks like every axis plot slash dot append style, and then I can put whatever I want. So here I put thick. Now every line has turned to thick. Now let's talk about changing the sizes of the marks. Let's start again with our prior plot and compile that. We'll see what we get there. Now, suppose we want to increase the size of the diamond. It's pretty small. In fact, the default size is 2pt, 2 points. And this means that the mark is sized so that it fits into a square with sides that are 2 times the mark size. So basically, the diamond that you see right now fits into a square that is 4 point by 4 point. We're going to change the mark size to be 3 point by just adding something to the add plot option. So we're going to change our mark size to 3 points. And now you see that the diamonds have gotten bigger. We can also go ahead and change it for the half circle, make that a little bigger. And then we can also change it for the stars. That looks a lot nicer. Let's talk about how to change the colors of the marks and the mystery of this key called mark color. Let me set up a simple plot. This time I'm just going to plot two lines just to make things a little simpler. And I'm making the marks really big. All of them are going to be 3 PT so we can see what's going on over here. By default, marks inherit the color of the plot as we see over here. Suppose we want to change the color of the squares in the first plot to be magenta. There's an option called mark color that you might think would change the mark color. Let's see what happens if I add it here. So I say mark color equals magenta, and has no effect at all. To actually change the mark color, we had to instead use a more complicated option. We append the pre-existing every mark style with our desired color. So I'm saying every mark slash dot append style equals magenta, and so that makes the mark be drawn in magenta. We can get even fancier specifying different draw and fill options. So I could say draw equals magenta and fill equals lime, and then we get these very complicated marks. So what is mark color anyway? It turns out to be the secondary color of the half markers, like half circle. So the default half color is white. We can change it in this half circle to yellow. So if I add mark color equals yellow, then we'll see what happens over here. You're going to see this white is going to fill in with yellow instead. It's a good idea to use different line styles in a graph because it makes it easier to differentiate the different lines in the plot. So let me give you an example of that here. I'm using a bunch of different line styles. I'm using dashed and densely dotted and dash dot and just plain dotted. And then you can see the effect over here, and actually it looks horrible, right? And what has happened is that the line styles have been inherited by the markers. So this is a serious problem. There's no reason that this should happen by default, and we could just fix it in this picture, but I want to give you a PGFPLOTS set way of fixing it that you can actually put at the top of your document. Today, we'll just put it above our picture, but in general, I'm going to recommend that you put this at the top of your document. What I'm saying here is that for every axis plot, so every time we have an add plot, add the option that every mark should have its style appended with solid. And this means that the way that the mark is drawn will not inherit the dashed or dotted style of the line, but instead always be solid. So I would recommend putting these lines at the top of your document. If you want to plot data from two different files, that's actually very easy. I'll go ahead and put an example here. What you can see here is that we have two addplot commands. The first reads from data.txt, and the second reads from points.txt. And so we see the result over here. I've also added a legend so that we can see that the blue with the pluses comes from data.txt and the dashes with the circles comes from points.txt. Remember that by default, the x values are the first column and the y values are the second column. I didn't specify those here, and so we're just using those first and second columns from each file. Finally, let me mention how to get loglog plots. I'll put an example picture here that does not have a loglog plot. I'll compile that. This is reading from the file compress.txt, which I'm mirroring below. And when we plot that, we get something where some of the dots are shoved together. Really, this should be in logarithmic scale. One way to get a loglog plot is to specify the modes using X mode and Y mode options. So for each of these, you could specify either log or linear. Another way to do it is just to change the type of axes. So I'm going to change this entire environment to be a loglog axis rather than just a plain axis. Then I don't have to specify the modes in my axis options. The other choices are semi-log x-axis and semi-log y-axis with no spaces at all. I hope you enjoyed today's video. You should now be able to create line plots using PGFPLOTS in LaTeX. There's a link to the Overleaf document we created today in the show notes. On that Overleaf site, we also have the data files. Please click like or subscribe if you want more videos like this. You can also buy my book, Unlocking LaTeX Graphics, at your favorite book retailer. Thanks.